astronaut. Then he told me that factor analysis has not been covered. And you cannot do structure equation modeling without factor analysis. So you should have a knowledge of factor analysis before coming over to the structure equation modeling. So in half an hour, I'll try to give you one example of factor analysis, and then we will move on to structure equation modeling. But those who will miss, I think I cannot do anything because session time is session time. One has to be attentive. Okay, let me share the screen. Just give me a moment. Is my desktop visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I will start with factor analysis and then we will move on to structure equation modeling. I can just cover the basics of structure equation modeling because structure equation modeling is such an advanced topic that I generally conduct full 3 days workshop on structure equation modeling. Last to last month, I conducted in Mumbai, and you cannot learn all the things of structure equation modeling in one lecture. But anyhow, I can just brief out some of the basics and how you can enter the data, how you can test the validity, reliability of the latent factors and so on. So some definitions. But before that, let's try to move on to, first of all, the factor analysis part. Okay. So this topic will cover your factor analysis and structure equation modeling. Is PPT is visible now? Yes, please. Is this visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, all right.
So let's go for factor analysis. As the name suggests, factor analysis, that means we have to extract certain factors during the analysis. While performing the analysis, we need to extract certain factors. That's why the name comes factor analysis. How you can factorize the set of the data into some manageable form. Let me just repeat. How you can factorize the set of variables into some manageable form is basically the task of factor analysis. So factor analysis is a general name denoting the class of procedure primarily used for data reduction and summarization. So basically, factor analysis is a data reduction technique. I'll give you one example so that clearly you can understand what is the meaning of factor analysis. So basically, it is a data reduction technique or generally called summarization technique. So there is no concept of dependent and independent variables in factor analysis. Let me just repeat, there is no concept of dependent and independent variables in factor analysis. So all the variables are taken together and the dimensionality is reduced. So it's a dimension reduction technique. You can note down side by side, everything is not possible to explain. If you are carrying a pen or a paper or a pencil, please. So it's a dimension reduction technique and there is no concept of dependent and independence in factor analysis, right? Now, question is where to apply factor analysis and where this technique is applicable. Generally, factor analysis technique is applicable whenever our variables are correlated among themselves. Let me emphasize once again, then the variables are correlated. Let's say you have 25 variables. If they are some kind of correlation between them. So if variables are correlated, then and only then factor analysis technique will work. If there is no correlation between the variables, there is no need to apply factor analysis because you cannot reduce the dimensionality of your variables. It is just like this. I'll give you a simple example. Let's say in an organization, there are three computer personnels who are working and all the three are doing the same kind of task, right? And then there is one clerk and then there is one person who is from, let's say, manager or something like that. They are doing their individual tasks, but there are three people, computer personnels. Now, obviously, all these computer personnels, they are related to each other. So after working for 2 months, the owner realizes that this work can be handled by only two people rather than three. So whosoever was a little bit weaker, he removed that because all of them were related. All of them were related. And only two people can serve or share the workload rather than three. So he has reduced the dimensionality from 3 to 2. That is the idea of this factor analysis. Factor analysis is basically an interdependence technique, and it is a dimension reduction technique. So factor analysis is used in the following circumstances: to identify the underlying dimensions or factors that explains the correlation among the set of variables. So how this dimension reduction technique is carried out, I'll give you the complete procedure. Then to identify a new or smaller set of uncorrelated variables. So whenever these factors are extracted, generally they are uncorrelated. And if they are uncorrelated, they can be further used in analysis. Like, let's say we apply multiple regression analysis. In multiple regression analysis, if the independent variables are correlated, then there is a problem of multicollinearity, right? There may be a problem of autocorrelation. But when the variables are uncorrelated, then you can easily do the multiple regression analysis. So when these factors are extracted, they are generally uncorrelated. And if they are uncorrelated, they can be further used in analysis like discriminant analysis or regression analysis or multivariate analysis. They can be further used, while these factors which have been extracted out of the factor analysis can be further used. Okay. How many people have joined? Let me see. How many people have joined so far? So that if you miss this example, there are 12 people anyhow. It's fine. So there are 12 people. So at least some of them, they can follow this example. I'll explain you the example of factor analysis through a very simple example of mall. In every big city, there are malls in Nagpur, in Calcutta, in Chandigarh, in Delhi. People are having big, big malls right now, right? For example, in Chandigarh, there is Elante Mall, which is so big that there is a parking of about 6,500 cars. So 6,500 cars can be parked in that particular mall. So you can very well imagine how big it will be. If you don't have a mobile phone and you are lost somewhere, it is difficult to trace out. Anyhow, so let me give you this example of mall. Now the owner of the mall, it's a hypothetical example, but this will give you crux of the factor analysis. The owner of the mall hire a team of researchers and give them this task that you have to tell me that how I can improve upon my facilities available in the mall. Then this team of researchers designed a questionnaire, right? And obviously they have to focus on many parameters: cleanliness, entertainment, food court, brands, games, parking, etc. They have to focus on so many things so that they can come out with certain manageable number of variables, and they can give certain suggestion to the owner of the mall that these are the variables you have to look for and these are the most important variables, right? Okay. Now let's say they design a questionnaire and some questions, 15 questions are related to cleanliness. Cleanliness of malls, cleanliness of floors, cleanliness of ramps, cleanliness of toilets. So 15 variables measured on 5-point scale or a 7-point scale. Let's say there are 15 variables which are concerned with cleanliness. Then entertainment is also a very, very important component of the mall. Then there are 16 to right up to 35, 20 variables. They are related with entertainment, which kind of movies they are playing, old or new movies, which kind of English or Hindi movies or something like that. So there are 20 variables which are concerning with the entertainment. Then again, 15 variables, they are related to the parking space, because if there is not enough parking space, then obviously people will not go to the mall. So whether there is a multiple parking space, whether the charges are nominal or not, or there is an increase after every hour, or there is a full day charges and so on. So people, they have 15 questions relating to the parking space. Then obviously games for children is also very, very important. Whenever particularly young couple goes to the mall, they would like to take dinner. They would like that there should be some entertainment. There should be some games for children. They look from every angle, right? So there are digital game, computerized games. So there are 25 questions related to games for children in that questionnaire. I'm talking of a questionnaire. Then obviously in a mall, there are different varieties of brands. Then there are about 25 variables which are related to different kinds of brands which are available in the mall. And then food court, whether it is having McDonald's, Sagar Ratna, or it is having a pizza, etc., Pizza Hut and so on, right? Or maybe some people like Punjabi Huts and so on. So all these things they look into, and 20 variables they are related to the food court. So in all and all, if you add all the variables together, it is 120. So you design a questionnaire, the team of researchers design a questionnaire which is having 120 questions. Now, here is an important question for you, which is written in the bracket. Do you think that all the 120 will be important which you have included in your questionnaire? Yes. Anybody can respond, please? Do you think all the 120 will be important? Yes, please. Anybody can respond? Yes or no?
No, sir.
Yeah. There may be, obviously, you are having a 120 questions. If you try to fill up these and give it to the customer, and he will fed up with 120 questions, right? He will say, do hell with, I'm here to enjoy. I'm not here to fill up your performa for another 1 hour, right? So I remember three, four years back, one girl from Guru Nanak Dev University, she came to me and she was carrying a questionnaire with 300 questions in that questionnaire. And she asked me to fill it up. It was related to students and teachers. I said, who has designed this questionnaire? She says, and how come you have 300 questions? She says, sir, I have two guides and each of the guide has given me 100 questions. So there are 200 questions and 100 I have worked out. So there are 300 questions. So you can very well imagine who will fill up the questionnaire with 300 questions. Then I asked her that your technique is totally wrong. Maybe you are not guided properly. Then I asked her that how many questionnaires you have filled up so far. She says 30 to 35. We able to analyze the data for 30 to 35 using the factor analysis. And believe me, we able to reduce the number of factors from 300 to just 52 factors, 52 variables. So she was very happy. Now awarded degree and all that. Reducing from 300 to 52 is a big task. And we did that for her. And she was very happy, right? Filling 52 questions is easier rather than 300, right? So that's why it is called dimension reduction technique. Because all of them may not be important. If some of them are not important, obviously, why we should include? Let's say out of 120, you work out certain factors. Let's say these factors are only 20, 25 questions are important. Then you can tell the owner of the mall that these are the important variables which you have to focus on. Rest of the things are not important. He will be happy. You will also be happy. You have given something from the research point of view, right? That is the idea of dimension reduction. The question is how this dimension reduction takes place. So factor analysis reduces them to a manageable number of factors. First of all, you need to understand what do you mean by factors or components. So I will be using the term factor or component. They are not known to you. That's why this is sometimes also called a latent variable. What is a latent variable? Which cannot be observed directly, but it is observed through some. For example, you cannot measure cleanliness. But cleanliness measured, it can be measured through some other variables, right? These variables are V1, V2, V15. But so this is called a factor. So cleanliness is one of the factors you can think of. It is not directly measurable, but it is measured through these 15 variables. So this is what do you mean by a factor? Factor is unknown, right? So factor analysis reduces them to a manageable number of factors or component, which explains the maximum variation present in the data. Okay. And also find the important factors which are emerging out of the entire factor analysis. Now, let me give you some idea how these factors are extracted, because mathematics is a little bit tough. So I'll not go into mathematics. Now, there are 120 questions. Obviously, there will be a variation present in the data. If you look at the mean standard deviation, variance, etc., there will be variation present in your data. Okay. Now, let's say I look, first of all, this factor analysis, look for the linear combination of variables. Now, you must be wondering, what is this linear combination? You can note down, suppose there are two variables, V1 and V2. Then the linear combination of V1 and V2 is denoted by L is equal to, you can write down smaller or capital L, is equal to small a1 v1 plus small a2 v2. This is called the linear combination of two variables. And if you are having three variables, you can add the third one, small a3 v3. If you are having k components, so it will be a1 v1 plus a2 v2 plus a3 v3 plus so and right up to ak vk if there are k variables. So this is called a linear combination. So what is this factor analysis technique basically?
So what is A? It is weight.
Yeah.
Weightage.
A1, A2, AK, they are generally known as weights or generally called factor weights, right? For example, if there are only two components, V1 and V2, let's say then your linear combination will be A1, V1 plus A2, V2. Let's say your A1 is 0.2. It will lie between 0 and 1 and A2 is 0.8. Then obviously the weight of X2 variable or the V2 variable is more than V1. So V1 is having more weightage than V2 is having more weightage than V1. So the higher the weight, the more importance will be given to the particular variable.
This but is sir, how mean. To determine the exact value of weight.
This is the idea of factor analysis. I will perform and tell you. Okay. I will perform and tell you how these weights are coming out.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Just try to understand. Understand the terms, I think then you will be more clear. So linear combination is clear. So what the factor analysis does actually, first of all, there are 120 variables. So it looks into the linear combination of variables. So there is a technique which is called principal component analysis, generally known as PCA. So what is this PCA, principal component analysis? It is a technique which looks into the linear combination of variables, which explains the maximum variation present in your data. And this linear combination is, first linear combination is called the first principal component, and we denote it by factor one, let's say F1, right? So F1 may become in F1, there may be variable V2, there may be variable V7, there may be variable V14, then variable V17, V23 or something like that. Let's say in factor one, there are 10 variables which have been come out of the 120, which explains, let's say 40% of the variation present in your data. So F1 is a linear combination of 10 variables. Let me just repeat, F1, which is a factor or a component or a latent variable, one and the same thing. So F1 is a linear combination of certain variables. They are 10 in numbers. They are coming from this only, which explains, let's say, 40% of the variation present in your data. And this is called the first factor or the first principal component. So F1 is having 10. Now, how many you have already? 120 in your questionnaire. So 10 have been captured by F1. Now you are left with 120 minus 10. You are left with 110 now. So again, it works out on the same principle. Again, look for the linear combination of another variables out of 110, not out of 120 now. And let's say this time 8 variables have come up and they are under factor 2, right? And let's say they are explaining 30% of the variation present in your data. So F1 explains 40% of the variation present in the data. F2 explains 30% of the variation present in the data. And how many variables? 10 variables in F1 and 8 variables in F2. So 18 variables altogether, they have explained 70% of the variation present in the data. Then you are 120 minus 18. You are left with 102. Then again, it tried to look for the linear combinations out of 102 and come out with the third factor. We call this as F3. And let's say this time, this includes 7 variables. And this explains 20% of the variation present in the data. So first factor explained 40%, that is F1. F2 explains 30% and F3 explains 20% of the variation present in the data. Now, in all and all, F1, F2, and F3, they are explaining how, what is the percentage of the variation explained. It is 40 plus 30 plus 20. 90% of the variation of your entire data has been explained by these three factors, F1. And how many variables? In first factor, we have 10. In second factor, we have 8. In third factor, we have 7. So in, if you add 10 plus 8 plus 7, it is 25. So out of 120, you're able to extract three factors, and this include only 25 variables, which can explain 90% of the variation present in your data. That means rest of the 120 minus 25, you are left with 95. So 95 variables are explaining which percentage of the variation of the data, 10%. They can be left out. So these 95 may not be important for you. You follow my point, right? So you're able to reduce the dimensionality from 120 to just 25. And you can tell the owner of the mall that these are the important 25 factors. They may be, some factors may be related to, let's say only three factors are related to cleanliness out of 15. Let's say only four factors are related to entertainment, two factors for parking, and so on. So 25 factors, 25 variables, right? You're able to extract and you're able to reduce that dimensionality from 120 to 25. That is the idea of doing factor analysis, right? Number one. Number two, you must be wondering that how these factors will come out. Somebody was already asking. As I mentioned, these factors are based on principal component analysis technique, which is a mathematical technique, right? And then only those factors will be important for you. There is a term in mathematics, which is called eigenvalues, which is, please remember, eigenvalue. So only those factors will be important for you whose eigenvalue will be more than one. If any factor is having eigenvalue less than one, this particular factor will not be important for you. Let's say first three factors are having eigenvalue more than one. First factor is having eigenvalue, say 7.2. Second is having 5.3. And the third one is having, say, 1.3. And F4 is having 0.4. F5 is having 0.6. So they are below one. So that means you will extract only first three factors, F1, F2, F3, right? Rest of them are not important for you. So this is based on eigenvalues. And we extract these factors, right? And once we extract these factors, then this type of analysis is called factor analysis. And basically there are two types of factor analysis. What I explained is called EFA. EFA is called explanatory factor analysis. Now, there will be some variables under factor one. There'll be some variables under factor two. There'll be some variables under factor three. Now, if there is some well-defined theory that these variables are related to customer satisfaction, these variables are related to perception, these variables are related to staff competence, these variables are related to easiness and reliability, then I want to confirm, based on the theory, whether these are actually falling into a particular domain or not. And that is the task of structure equation modeling. So once we apply the factor analysis and certain variables are coming out of factor analysis, we want to confirm that these variables are really belong to this factor or not. And that is the task of structure equation modeling. And that kind of factor analysis is called CFA, means confirmatory factor analysis. Further, we want to confirm that these are actually falling under a particular factor or a construct. These variables are falling under the second construct. These variables are falling under the third construct. So that is the idea of factor analysis and confirmatory factor analysis. And these two terms are known as in literature, EFA and CFA. So EFA means explanatory factor analysis, and CFA means confirmatory factor analysis. EFA you can do in SPSS, but CFA you have to do by using factor MOS, analysis of movement structure. Yes, please. Is the basic idea clear? Hello. Is the basic idea clear?
Yes, sir.
Anybody?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So I have given you a very simple example of factor analysis, right? So there are many problems of factor analysis in mental health, in sociology, in psychology, in economics. For example, positive mental health variables, they include certain set of variables which include life satisfaction, just like cleanliness, happiness, psychological well-being, positive strengths. Similarly, variables may also be anxiety, depression, stress, spirituality, quality of life, social support, relationship satisfaction, right? So all these variables can be studied with the help of a factor analysis. Okay, there are many other examples in psychological distress, psychological well-being. So you must have seen that anxiety, depression. Once you analyze these factors, so these four important domains has come out. Once you analyze these factors, these are the variables which have come out. Six factors have been extracted here. Four factors have been extracted. They are coming out of the factor analysis. Okay, so how these factors are extracted? This is, let's say I put I is equal to 1. Then you will get W11 X1, W12 X2, W13 X3, W1K XK. So it looks into the linear combination, and those variables which will be falling under this linear combination will be given name as F1. Similarly, when I replace I with 2, then it will become F2, then F3, and so on. And we have to stop there. If F1 is having eigenvalue more than 1, it will be retained. If F2 is having eigenvalue more than 1, it will be retained. Let's say F3 is having eigenvalue less than 1. So just two factors will be extracted then, right? And these WIs are called weights. So in a particular factor, you just look for, let's say X3 is having more weight than any rest of them, then this variable will be having more importance rather than the other variables. So you can look for the importance of variables in factor analysis also. Okay. So it is possible to select weights or factors, scores, coefficients, so that the first factor explains the largest portion of the total variation. And this is done with the help of principal component analysis. Then a second set of weights can be selected, which can give you the second factor, but it will be uncorrelated with the first one, because those variables which have appeared in F1, they are not likely to appear in F2, right? So F1 and F2 will be uncorrelated with each other. Similarly, if there is F3 also, which is having eigenvalue more than 1, then this F3 will be uncorrelated with F1 as well as with F2, right? So same principle you can apply it to work out the additional components. Okay, now whether your data is applicable for factor analysis or not, there are two important tests. What are these two important tests? These two important tests are basically, the first test is called Bartlett test of sphericity. What do you mean by this? Actually, as I mentioned, that the factor analysis technique is applicable whenever variables are correlated among themselves, right? Now, suppose all the variables are uncorrelated, then you cannot reduce the dimensionality. There is only one computer personnel in that organization. If you remove that, who will handle the work of the computer? You cannot do that. But if there are two, three people working on the same, if one is not there, at least rest of the two can handle. This is what do you mean by this thing. So Bartlett test of sphericity test whether the correlations are zero or they are different from zero. So obviously this value has to be significant. Under H0, we test that there is no pairwise correlation between the variables. Alternative will be that there is a correlation. So I want to reject H0. So this value has to be significant. So Bartlett test of sphericity, p value must be less than 0.05. Remember, first test for factor analysis. Second test is called KMO test. It is a test for sampling adequacy, whether your sample size is appropriate to conduct the factor analysis or not, right? So KMO value must be between 0.5 to 1. I'm not saying 0.05. I'm saying between 0.5 to 1. You can note down, please. KMO value should be between 0.5 to 1 and between half to 1, you can think of, between half to 1. If KMO value is coming out to be 0.3 or 0.4, that means you cannot apply factor analysis to your data. That is the idea. So there are two important tests which will appear when we will perform the analysis, KMO and Bartlett. Your first aim is to check KMO and Bartlett. KMO value must be between 0.5 to 1 and Bartlett test value must be significant. If these two are intact, let's say one of them is violated, let's say KMO is 0.3 and Bartlett test of spherticity is, it is significant, you cannot even apply. Or KMO value is adequate, let's say 0.7, but Bartlett test of spherticity is non-significant, you cannot apply. Both of them has to follow the same rule. So Bartlett test of spherticity value must be significant. Number one, KMO should be between, here I have written, between 0.5 to 1, right? It has to be between 0.5 to 1. Then you can apply factor analysis. Okay, then some terms will be there, which I will be discussing in structure equation modeling as well as factor analysis. One of the term will be commonality. What is commonality? Commonality, let's say there are 10 variables. For each variable, factor analysis will give you commonality. Let's say commonality of V1, variable number one, is 0.723. It will lie between 0 and 1. And commonality of V2 is 0.65. So what is the meaning of 0.725? That means how much variation this variable shares with the rest of the variables. So if there are 10 variables and commonality of V1 is 0.72, that means V1 shares 72% of the variation with the rest of the 9 variables which are present in your analysis. This is what we mean by commonality. So this is, commonality is the amount of variance a variable, one variable, shared with the rest of the other variables is called commonality. Let's say variable number 3 is there, whose commonality is 0.45. That means this variable is very poor. This variable only shares 45% of the variation with the rest of the 9 variables present in the analysis. So generally, we want to retain that kind of variable which at least have 50% commonality. That means commonality should be more than 0.5, right? Commonality should be more than 0.5. Then eigenvalues. Eigenvalues represent the total variation explained by each factor. For example, F1 is having eigenvalue, say, they will be always placed in order. First F1, then F2, then F3. F1 will explain maximum, F2 will be the next maximum, F3 will be the next maximum, right? And so it explains that this F1 explains this much percentage of the variation, F2 explains this much percentage of the variation in terms of eigenvalue. So more the eigenvalues, more variation will be there, explained by that particular factor. Then there will be factor loading. Factor loading are nothing but simple correlation between variables and factors, right? Then factor loading plot you will get, that will give you a very clear picture. Then factor matrix will also appear, that will be based on factor loadings. Then factor scores you can compute. For example, if weights are known to you from the data and you give value to V1, V2, V3, right, then F1 can be worked out. That will give you factor score. Then percentage of variance out of the total variation explained. Each factor is explaining what percentage of variation. And residuals are nothing but the observed correlation coefficient you have between the variables. And then it will work out the estimated correlation coefficients. These are also called reproduced correlations from your model. And residuals will be nothing but the difference between the two. So if the difference between the two, that means the observed correlation and reproduced correlation is very less, that means your model is good. The residuals has to be small. It is just like difference between estimated value and actual value. Okay. Then scree plot will give you a clear cut idea. It is a plot of, on y-axis we have eigenvalues, on x-axis we have different factors, F1, F2, F3. And only those factors will be important whose eigenvalue is more than 1. So it will give you a very clear idea that these are the factors which are important. Then correlation matrix will also appear. Then principal component analysis is used in the extraction of the variables. And sometimes people have the prior knowledge that 3 factors can be extracted out of this data, or 4 factors can be extracted out of this data. But generally, it's better to let the data speak. So if you give the data should speak that how many factors are important, then it will be based on eigenvalues. So sometimes people also use prior information if there are some fixed number of components, but generally they are not. So it should be based on the data, and eigenvalues will give you how many important factors can be extracted. And obviously F1 has to be uncorrelated to F2. If there is F3 also, then F3 should be uncorrelated with F1 as well as F2. right? And F2 should be uncorrelated with F1 and F3 and so on. So how they are uncorrelated, how they becomes uncorrelated. So we have to rotate the matrix actually. And that rotation is called Verimax procedure. So in factor analysis, we use the Verimax procedure to rotate the components at 90 degree so that F1 gets uncorrelated with F2, right? So you will not have to remember all this because once you, the problem is clear where we can apply factor analysis, then you just have to carry out certain steps. So you just remember that we have to use Verimax method. That's it. So this is the idea of scree plot. Let's say these are the factors F1, F2, F6 and eigenvalues. So if you drop a line from here, eigenvalue more than one. So only one factor, two factors are important. Rest of them, they are having eigenvalue less than one. This is less than one. This is less than one, less than one. So these are components of the factors. They are having eigenvalue less than one. So only two factors will be extracted. That is the idea of this scree plot. So four things we have to look for. As I mentioned, commonality has to be more than 0.5. And if there are low loadings for certain variables, they should be removed. There should not be cross loadings. Cross loadings means one variable should not be loaded to one factor as well as another factor. We try to see the reasons for that particular. I will give you examples. Then for each factor, there will be certain variables. And those variables which are under a particular factor, we need to check the reliability of those variables. And that is checked through, which is called Cronbach alpha, internal consistency of the data. So in SPSS, this is how we perform. We will go to data reduction, we will go to factor analysis, and then we'll perform the analysis. So with this background, let me give you one example of factor analysis before moving on to the structure equation modeling. Okay. All right. So I'll give you an example and then you will be more clear. So let me open one of the file of factor analysis in SPSS and explain you the meaning of factor analysis and how you can perform. You can note down steps, please. So this is the file of factor analysis. Okay, so very small data set, and I'll explain you the meaning of this data set. It is some variables are measured on 7-point scale. And what are these variables? Now, when people go to market to buy toothpaste, please try to understand the example. When people go to market to buy toothpaste, they look from different angles. Some people are worried about that it should strengthen our gums. Some people say it should prevent cavities. Some people are very much worried about the shining teeth, attractive teeth, something like that. So there is a questionnaire which has been developed to capture this consumer behavior of how, why, which are the things which generally, I mean, people, how they buy the particular toothpaste. So first question was asked, important to buy toothpaste that prevent cavities, whether this is important for you or not. If it is very important, he will give this as number 7. If it is not important, he will give this as number 1 or number 2. Similarly, I like toothpaste that give shining teeth. Some people are very much, I forget about cavities or about anything else. I just need shining teeth. If it is very important for him, he will rate this as 7. If not important, he will rate this as 1 or 2. Or if it is in between, let's say I like, yes, it should be 3, 4, something like that. Then a toothpaste should strengthen gums. This is again 7-point scale. I prefer toothpaste that freshens breath. Then tooth decay benefit offered by the toothpaste, buying a toothpaste for attractive teeth. So these are the variables and their behavior has been captured here on a 7-point scale, right? Is the data clear now? Yes, please. Is this data clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now we will perform factor analysis on this. Let's perform factor analysis. So you can note down the steps. Go to analysis. In analysis, go to data reduction because factor analysis is a data reduction technique. Go to factor. And as I mentioned, there is no concept of dependent or independent variable in factor analysis. So just simply press Control A. All of the variables will be marked. If you are putting a serial number, please do not include serial number into analysis. That is just a serial number. Only responses have to be included. Take this to the right hand side. Then there is an option of selection variables. Selection variable means, let's say I divide this data into male and female also, right? And male is given code as 1, female is given code as 2. And I want to see whether the female preference or the male preference, they differ or not. Or I want to perform separate factor analysis for male, separate factor analysis for female. So in that case, you can select this variable gender and give the value. It is asking value. It will be highlighted. Give value as 1. Value 1 means male data will be selected, and value 2 means female data will be selected. But there is no male and female. We are doing it this on total. I'm just telling you that this is option available. Okay. So go to descriptives. Please note down the steps. Go to descriptives. Go to univariate descriptives. Then correlation. We need correlations between different variables, between V1, V2, V3, V4, and so on. So correlation coefficients, their significance levels. Determinant you don't require. KMO and Bartlett, the most important test. They will tell you whether your factor analysis technique is applicable or not. And reproduced correlation. Reproduced means you have the original set of correlations, and then you develop a model, and based on that developed model, again, correlations will be worked out. And residuals or the reproduced correlations, and below this reproduced correlation matrix, you will get the residuals. So residuals have to be closer to 0. If they are, then you are through with the model. Okay. That's all in this. Continue. Let's go to extraction now, the second component. It is by default, it is a principal component, and we need only principal component. There are other methods also, oblique rotation, alpha factorizing, but they are not for factor analysis, please. So they are meant for some other purpose. Click on to scree-plot also. Now, as I mentioned, sometimes we have the prior information that from this data, 3 or 4 factors can be extracted. If you have prior information, you can fix the number of factors to 3 or 4. But generally, we don't have any idea. So if the data has to speak about the number of factors, then the first option is better based on the eigenvalue. And only those factors will be extracted whose eigenvalue is more than 1. All right. So then continue. Then go to rotation. If you remember, which rotation was best? Varimax. So click on to Varimax, because it is based on orthogonality principle that F1 will be uncorrelated with F2. So Varimax procedure is best for factor analysis. Also click on to loading plots. Continue and then move on to scores. And in scores, you save as variables. I mean, F1 will be saved. If there are 2 factors, then F2 will also be saved. And if you work out the correlation between F1 and F2, it will be 0. There is no need to display the factor score coefficient matrix, right? So just continue from here. Where if 2 factors are extracted, they will be placed next to here. So F1 will be placed here, F2 will be placed here. So those 2 factors will be extracted out of these 6 variables. Continue. Okay. Then options. In options, if there are missing values present in your data, you can replace with mean. You can use this option. But in our case, there is no missing value, so we will not have to exclude anything. Now, as I mentioned, that first factor will be having some combination of variables. Second factor will be having certain combination of variables, right? Then what to do? You have to sort it by size, that which factor is most important. So which variables under these factors are more important, right? Let's say there are 3 variables under factor F1. And if you are not sorting by size, then the least important variable may come first, the maximum may come in between, and somewhere the other variable will appear. But if you want that the maximum weightage, that should appear number 1, then number 2, number 3, then sort it by size. And as I mentioned, that we don't want correlations, we don't want variables which are having very, very less commonalities. So generally, because this is a small data set, so let me suppress those which are having commonality to be less than 0.3. Generally, we less than 0.4, sometimes also applicable for large data set. Continue. That's all. So your factor analysis is over. You will not have to do any mathematics. Press OK and you will get the analysis done for factor. So press OK and here is your result. So this is the result. So first of all, mean and SD table, there are 30 variables on 30 observations only. So these are, this is just a mean SD table of each variable, variable number V1, V2, V3. And I have put the name there. For example, variable number one was important to buy toothpaste that prevent cavities. I like toothpaste that give me shining teeth, something like that. And this is a correlation matrix. As I mentioned, some correlations have to be there. For example, correlation between V1 and V3 is high. Then correlation between, let's say, V5 and V1 is also high. Then correlation between V6 and V4 is also 0.64. So some correlation seems to be high. And this correlation between V2 and V4, there, that is also high. So some correlations are high, right? So rather than looking at this correlation matrix, important to go for KMO and Bartlett, because if your correlation matrix is very large, it's difficult to see which correlations are high, which are not. So straight away move on to KMO and Bartlett. So let's see the KMO and Bartlett value. So this is your KMO. So KMO value, if you remember, I told you that it should be between 0.5 to 1. And what is our KMO? 0.66. So it is between 0.5 and 1. Okay, fine. So first test is applicable. And Bartlett test of spherical, it is testing whether the correlations are significant or not. So this hypothesis has to be significant. So this you can see 0.000, that means it is less than 0.05, so it is significant. So both the tests are applicable to your data. If both are applicable to your data, suppose your significance level would have been 0.25 and Bartlett test is 0.32. Do not apply factor analysis to your data. So both these tests you need to check rather than checking correlations. This is important. Okay. Then this is the commonality. How much variation V1 shares with the rest of the other five variables? There are six variables. For example, commonality of variable number V1 is 0.926. That means this variable shares 92.6% of the variation with the rest of the five variables. Variable number two, this variable shares 72.3% of the variation with the rest of the variables, five variables, and so on. So this is what do you mean by commonality. Then how many factors? This is the main table. How many factors have been extracted? Factors and component one and the same thing. So here you can see this is eigenvalues. So we have to see the eigenvalues for those factors which are having more than one. For example, eigenvalue of component one, component means factor one, is 2.73. And this explains 45.5% of the variation present in your data, right? Second factor or a component, again, eigenvalue is 2.2. They are always placed in order. And this explains 36.9% of the variation. Both these factors, that explains the commonality, is 82.5% almost. So both these factors, that is explaining 42% of the variations present in your data. What about factor number three, less than one? Factor number four, less than one? Five, less than one? Six, less than one? So they are not important. These are not important for me. These are one and two, they are important. And that explains 82.5% of the data. Now, I don't know which variables are falling under factor one, which variables are falling under factor two. That will be given by rotated component matrix. I will show you. And here is the scree plot. So if you double click here and drop a line from here, here is the line you can drop. This line at, let's say, 0.1, because we want to extract all those eigenvalues which are more than one. So this is shifted to one. And you can see that these are eigenvalues. These two factors, factor number one, factor number two, their eigenvalue is more than one. While rest of these four factors, they are having eigenvalue less than one. So they are not important. These two are important. So let's see under F1, which are the variables? Under F2, which are the variables? Okay. So do not see this component matrix, please. This is not required. Do not see this component matrix. We need to see the components matrix which is coming after rotation. This is before rotation. This is before rotation. Please see the component matrix which is coming after rotation. So let's see these are reproduced correlations, the reproduced correlations, and this is the residuals. And you can see hardly there is any correlation then. Residual means the difference between the actual correlation and the predicted correlation. So if model is good, there will be hardly any correlation, residual correlation. And you can see all the correlations are almost zero. This is what we require, that the model is good, right? Okay. So here is the rotated component matrix which you need to see. There are two component matrix. First is without rotation. This is very confusing. Then you have to see only the rotated component matrix after rotation. This is after Verimax procedure. Okay. Here is Verimax procedure has been applied. Now this is your factor number one. This is your factor number two. Under factor number one, which are the variables under factor number one? V1, V3, V5. They are falling under factor number one. And let's see that under this V1, V3 and V5, what are these variables? Let's look at the nature of these variables. This first variable is to prevent cavities. So that means it is related to health. Second, V3, it should strengthen gums. It is also related to health of the teeth. Then tooth decay benefit offered by the paste. This is also related to health, right? So that my teeth should not fall. It should give strength to the teeth. So this is related to health. So now all the three, you look at the nature of these variables, V1, V3, V5, they are related to something like health benefit factor. You please remember, SPSS will not assign name to the factor. You have to assign yourself. Let me just repeat. SPSS will not assign name to a particular factor. You have to assign yourself based on the nature of the variables. Let's say in the mall example, some variables under factor one, they are coming from cleanliness, and some of them are coming from entertainment. So I can call this factor as cleanliness and entertainment factor, combined both of them, right? So here clearly these are all related to health of the teeth. So I can call this as health benefit factor. Name I have to assign. Let's see that in factor two, which variables are coming out. Variable number six, this says, I want to buy death foods which give attractive teeth, something like cosmetic type of thing. I prefer toothpaste that freshens breath. Again, something like cosmetic. He's not bothered about cavities and something like that. I like toothpaste that should give shining teeth. Again, something like cosmetic. So these factors, they are basically from the social point of view. I can call this factor name as maybe cosmetic factor or the social benefit factor, whatever you want to give, right? So two factors have been extracted. One of them I have given the name as health benefit factor, and another name I have given the social benefit factor or the cosmetic factor, right? So two factors have been extracted, and three variables under this. If somebody want to ask you that I want to buy death paste which is having the highest benefit factor and highest social benefit factor, so just ask him to focus on two components, V1 and from here V6, because this contains the highest priority for social benefit, this contains the highest priority for cavities, health point of view. And you can see given the sorted command, so they have been placed in order. This variable gets the most important place in your factor analysis. V1, then V3, then V5, then comes V6, then comes other. So they have been sorted accordingly, right? So this is the idea of performing factor analysis. Now, there is no cross-loading. Sometimes one variable may cross-load here also. It is giving 0.34 here, and it is giving 0.123 here. That means some part is cross-loaded here, right? Something like you can think of, some person is beautiful also, somebody is intelligent also. Your one factor is intelligent, another is beauty, right? So there may be cross-loading. So in that case, if loading, generally we consider that where the loading is high, then this has to be removed from here. So we consider under this factor where the loading is high. Remember this, right? Okay. And this you can clearly see V1, V3, V5, they are under falling factor 1, and V2, V4, V6, they are under fall. They are placed at 90 degree. That means there is no correlation. And where are these factors in a factor analysis? We save them. This is your factor 1, this is your factor 2. And they should be uncorrelated. If you want to check, go to correlation and check the correlation between them. Between F1, this is your F1, this is your F2. And see, the correlation matrix is 0. So correlation between 1 and 2 is 0. P value is more than 0.05. It is 1. So there is no correlation between F1 and F2. And they can be further used for analysis in, you can say, multiple regression or discriminant analysis, right? Okay. So this is the idea of doing factor analysis. Now, under factor 1, if you remember, we have variable V1, V3, V5. Then we have to see what is their Cronbach alpha. So how to see the Cronbach alpha? Go to analysis, go to scale, and under this scale, reliability. So variable number V1, variable number V3, variable number V5. This is V5. Is this V6 or V5? This is V5, I think. Let me see. Yeah, V5. I have to take this one. So now this is, you can see, this is V1, V3, V5. They are under all factor 1. And check their Cronbach alpha. It has to be more than 0.7. But if it is between 0.6 and 0.7, even then it is acceptable. Let's look at. So Cronbach alpha value will appear. So Cronbach alpha. Cronbach alpha, anyhow. So it is giving value as negative. I don't know. Where is this? But anyhow. So I will tell you in another example how to check this Cronbach alpha, but that is the idea of checking this Cronbach alpha. And then now two factors have been extracted. Factor one. Similarly, in many problems, 4, 5, 6 factors have been extracted. So first look for, is there any cross loading? Everything. Then we further move on to structure equation modeling, right? So let me quickly go through one more example and show it to you how we can perform factor analysis. So let me open one of the file, which will be, we will be using this file in factor analysis also. Okay. So this is a serial number here. Then the first variable is about customer satisfaction. Customer satisfaction, there are 4 variables related to customer satisfaction, C1 to C4, CS4. Then there is another variable, which is called ER. ER is called easiness and reliability. It is technology based. And this is also based on 4 questions. Then there is IS. IS stands for information and security. Information security. So there are 6 questions related to information and security. Then that there is last component, which is called SC. SC means staff competence. And there are 6 variables which are related to staff competence. And it's a huge data. It's a huge data. And we will see how we can perform factor analysis. And then we will perform structure equation modeling on this. Okay. And I'll tell you the Cronbach alpha also, because that was very small data set. So sometimes Cronbach alpha doesn't work. Okay. Analysis. Then dimension reduction, factor, and accept serial number. You have to take all of them. So take all of them to this side, not the serial number. Descriptive, same steps. I'm just repeating coefficient, significance level, KMO and Bartlett's, reproduced. Continue. Extraction is scree plot, principal unrooted component matrix. Okay, that's fine. Then rotation is Verimax. Loading plots, and then scores, save as a variable, and then options, let's say sorted by size, and suppress those which are having, let's say, because it's a huge data set, so I can take the liberty to go for 0.4. Continue. So your factor analysis for this is complete. Okay, and here is the answer. First, mean and SD table, then correlation table, very large table. Then just look for KMO and Bartlett. KMO says 0.92, which is between 0.5 to 1. Bartlett test is significant. Okay, fine. Commonality is, we can remove that particular variable where commonality is less than 0.5. So I don't think there is any variable whose commonality is less than 0.5. So all of them are more than 0.5. Fine. Then how many factors have been extracted? 4 factors have been extracted. And total variation explain is about 76.5%. So these are the eigenvalues which are more than 1, and these are the which is less than 1. So you will not have to bother about. First factor explain 49% of the variation. Second factor explain 13% of the variation. Third 8%. Fourth 5%. In all and all, you have 76.5%. That is cumulative given here. So 4 factors have been extracted. So do not see this component matrix. As I mentioned, see the rotated component matrix. So these are reproduced correlations. So they are very, very small now, you can see. Now, here is a problem of cross-loading. Now, before moving on to structure equation modeling, for example, one of the factor, IS1, IS stands for information security. This is loaded under factor number 2 and also loaded under factor number 4. So, but load here is more. So I should remove from here. So what we can do, just cut from here. So this is how you have to go about it. Similarly, this one, ER3, this is having a larger weight here, small weight here. So I'll remove from here, cut. So these are the 4 factors which have been extracted. So under this component, you have SC12, SC6. So how to check their Cronbach alpha? So go here. So SC1 to SC6. So go to analysis, go to scale reliability, and SC1 to SC6. SC1 right up to SC6. Check the Cronbach alpha. So you can check the Cronbach alpha is coming out to be 0.879. 0.879. That means any value which is more than 0.7 is good, but 0.6 to 0.7 is also acceptable. So the first factor which have been extracted in your factor analysis is having the Cronbach alpha value as 0.8 something. Similarly, you can check for this IS1 to IS6. Similarly, you can check for this one, CS1 to CS4. So if they are more than 0.7, 0.6, then they are further. Now, we have to move on to now structure equation modeling. This is the result of factor analysis. 4 factors have been extracted. They are put under 4 domains. So this domain is called customer satisfaction. This one, CS, is called customer satisfaction. ER domain is called easiness and reliability. SC is called staff competence. And IS is called information security. So 4 domains have been worked out. Now, what is the idea of doing CFA? This is the work of EFA. CFA means we want to confirm whether all this SC1 to SC6, whether they are actually based on the literature. Literature says that they are the components of staff competence. CFA is based on the hypothesis, certain hypotheses, which are well built in the literature. Then we move on to CFA. Otherwise, there is no need to move on to CFA. So we want to check further whether the variables which we have received under this factor, which is called staff competence, whether they actually lie under this or not. Because theory says they have to lie under this. Similarly, IS, whether they lie under information security or not. We want to confirm. Similarly, we want to confirm for this. We want to confirm for this. And for this, we apply what is called structure equation modeling, and that is called confirmatory factor analysis. So I'm stopping with factor analysis. If you have any question, you can ask me. Otherwise, I'll give you a 5-6 minutes break, and then we will come back and discuss about the structure equation modeling. Yes, please. Any question in structure in factor analysis?
Sir, yes, please. I'm Sravantia. Yes. I have a question. Sir, how can we develop an index through this principal component analysis? What will be the weights for the index?
weights I have already shown you. These are nothing but weights. You see, I think I close the output. Huh? Anyhow,
so,
I can run the output. I can show you. Just it will take 1 minute. Time and reduction factor. So everything is there now. Output will appear. This is the output, and these are the weights actually. Rotated component matrix. These are the weights.
Okay.
These are the weights. These are the weights. They are in order. They are in order. That this SC31, SC3 is the highest weightage. Goes to this. Next weightage goes to this. These are the weights. They will always lie between 0 and 1.
We are not decreasing the number of variables here. We are considering for indexing. We are considering all the variables we have included.
Yeah. Okay. Now, very important question. Let's say there is IS1. Let's suppose this loading is 0.500, and this would have been say 0.500, right? Suppose both the loads are same. Then I cannot drop this. I cannot drop this. Then what we generally do before moving on to factor, before moving on to structure equation modeling, we drop this IS1 because it is giving a cross loading.
Okay.
So we remove this, and then there will be 5 components under IS1. We will remove this. This is loading on both. So, and then we will go for the structure equation model. You follow my point?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Any other question, please? Any other question in factor analysis? Is this clear now? Factor analysis is clear? Yes, please. Is the factor analysis clear?
Very much clear to me.
Okay. Yes, please. Anybody want to ask question? I'll give you 2 minutes more, then 5 minutes break, and then we'll come back to structure equation modeling. Yes, please. No question?
I have one more question. Sir, do we need to check the normality of the variables? No.
It is not required in factor analysis. Let me tell you, it is not required in factor analysis.
Okay.
Right. Of course, normality is sometimes people also check the normality, because let's say you have a very, very small data set.
Yeah.
And generally factor analysis doesn't perform well if on a small data set, right? So if your KMO value and Bartlett value, they are not coming out to be in appropriate order, then sometimes we need to check the normality. Otherwise, most of the time we don't require. If KMO Bartlett fall in place, then there is no need to check.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So we will be back at 7:25. I'll give you 5 minutes break. And please, the structure equation modeling is a very, very, very important technique. Do not miss even a single word. Otherwise, you will be face difficulty in understanding. There is special terminology used, which I'll discuss after 5 minutes. Okay. So I'll be back in 5 minutes. Yes, Deya Shankarji, I'll be back in 5 minutes.
Okay, sir. Fine. No problem.
Okay.
দয়াশঙ্কর বাবু, আমি শ্রাবন্তী মাইতি বলছিলাম।
হ্যাঁ বলুন ম্যাডাম, আমি বুঝতে পারছি।
বলছি
মুখস্থ হয়ে গেছে।
না, আপনি যথেষ্ট ইন্টেলিজেন্ট মানুষ, এটা খুব স্বাভাবিক আপনার কাছে। হ্যাঁ বলছি, আমরা কি এই উনি যে পাওয়ার পয়েন্টে প্রেজেন্ট করছে, এটা কি আমরা পেতে পারি?
আপনি স্যারকে চাইবেন?
আচ্ছা, মানে ফ্যাক্টর অ্যানালিসিসটা হয়তো লাগবে না, কিন্তু এর পরের পার্টটা লাগবে আর কি। মানে আমার মনে হয় সবারই লাগবে।
হ্যাঁ ম্যাম, সবারই লাগবে, আমারও তাই মনে হচ্ছে।
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ, মানে স্ট্রাকচারাল ইকুয়েশনটা একদম একটা নতুন মানে টুলস ডেভেলপ হচ্ছে এবং ওয়াইডলি ইউজড হচ্ছে। সুতরাং আমি প্রথমত আপনাকে ধন্যবাদ জানাতে চাই এই রকম একটা টপিক আমাদের উপহার দেওয়ার জন্য। হ্যাঁ, অনেস্টলি স্পিকিং দয়াশঙ্কর বাবু, সব ক্লাস তো এনজয় করিনি, স্বাভাবিক ব্যাপার, আমার এরিয়া অফ ইন্টারেস্টে পড়ছে না। এটা খুব স্বাভাবিক, আমি মানে এটা তো হবে। হ্যাঁ, আমি মানে আমি চাইছি আমরা সবাই বলবো, আপনিও যদি একটু বলেন যে উনি যদি পিপিটিটা আমাদের
বলবেন। শুনুন, আপনাকে কমিটমেন্ট করলে রিভিউজ করতে পারবেন না, ঠিক আছে?
আচ্ছা আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে ঠিক আছে, আমি নিশ্চয়ই বলবো।
হ্যাঁ, আপনি বললে অটোমেটিক বলবেন, তখন আমি কি করতে পারবো, ফলো আপ করতে পারবো।
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ ঠিক আছে ঠিক আছে। আর ওনার ইমেল আইডিটা একটু আমাদের
সবাই, সব রিসোর্স পার্সনের ইমেল আইডি ফোন নাম্বার আমি পাঠিয়ে দেবো একসঙ্গে সবার।
আচ্ছা আচ্ছা আচ্ছা, না ওনাকে বোধ হয় অনেকেরই লাগবে, মানে এই ফ্যাক্টর অ্যানালিসিস একদম নতুন একটা টুল যেটা খুব ওয়াইডলি এখন ইউজ হচ্ছে, সেই জন্য খুব ইন্টারেস্টিং এই টপিকটা। উনি পড়ানো খুব ভালো, অসাধারণ পড়ায়।
না না, উনি প্রত্যেকটা জিনিস খুব বেসিক্যালি কনসেপচুয়ালি খুব ক্লিয়ার,
মানে কোনো কিছু প্রশ্ন করার আগেই মানে উনি সেই জায়গাটাকে ক্লিয়ার করে দিচ্ছেন আর কি।
উনি
বলে চলেছেন একদম।
পঞ্চানন্দা, পঞ্চানন্দা তো আমার ডাইরেক্ট টিচারও ছিলেন, পঞ্চানন্দা তো অসাধারণ পড়ান। আর সৌম্যদীপ স্যার, আমি স্যার বললাম, ও আমার কন্টেম্পোরারি, মানে আমরা একসাথেই ক্যালকাটা ইউনিভার্সিটিতে পড়াশোনা করেছি। হ্যাঁ, ওরও ক্লাস অসাধারণ একদম। বিশ্বজিৎদা, বিশ্বজিৎদা ওনার, বিশ্বজিৎদা যা প্রোফাইল চিন্তার বাইরে, মানে বিশ্বজিৎদা বিশ্বভারতীতে আছে বলে নাইলে ওনার তো বিদেশে থাকার কথা, এত ভালো প্রোফাইল।
চেষ্টা তো করেছি, দেখুন
খুবই ভালো। আমি তো বললাম আপনাকে, সব ক্লাস তো সবাই নিশ্চয়ই এনজয় করছে না, এটা খুব স্বাভাবিক, সব ক্লাস তো আমরা এনজয় করব না, কারণ সেগুলো তো আমাদের এরিয়া অফ ইন্টারেস্টও পড়ে না, অনেক কিছু আমরা বেসিক আইডিয়া না থাকলে তো সেটা এনজয় করা যায় না।
না সেটা তো হয়, তারপরে কি এটা একটা সব এরিয়া কভার করতে গেলে দেখা যায় না। এখন যেমন স্বপ্নেন্দু ব্যানার্জি ফোন করেছিলেন গেমস থিওরির জন্য, হ্যাঁ তো আমি বেসিকটা করুন, কারণ গেমস থিওরিতে হাই স্ট্যান্ডার্ডে গিয়ে লাভ নেই বেশি। হ্যাঁ, এই কম সময় মানে মিডিওকার লেভেলে রাখুন।
আপনি আমাদের সাথে যোগাযোগ রাখবেন, আমরা আরো এরকম প্রোগ্রামে পার্টিসিপেট করতে পারবো।
নিশ্চয়ই নিশ্চয়ই, না না আমি তো সবসময় টাচে থাকার চেষ্টা করি।
না আমার সত্যি ভালো লেগেছে, কালকে তো শেষ হয়ে যাবে প্রোগ্রামটা, আমার ভালো লেগেছে। আমি তো আপনাকে বারবারই বলছি যে সব ক্লাস তো করো না, স্বপ্নেন্দুদেরও খুব ভালো। আমি স্বপ্নেন্দুদের ওই যাদবপুর ইউনিভার্সিটির কথা বলছেন তো? স্বপ্নেন, হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ স্বপ্নেন্দুদা, হ্যাঁ আমি চিনি আর কি। আসলে আমার না একটু এই কোভিড এর জন্য কথা বলতে একটু কষ্ট হয়, সেই জন্য অনেক সময় আমি প্রশ্ন থাকলেও করতে পারছি না, মানে আমার এখনো ব্রেথলেসনেস একটা প্রবলেম থাকে, মানে অনেকদিন থাকে এই সমস্যাগুলো জানেন তো।
যাবে 3 মাস?
হ্যাঁ 3 মাস, উইকনেস তো আছেই, এই অন্যান্য সমস্যাগুলো থাকে। তার মধ্যে আমার একটু সিরিয়াস হয়ে গিয়েছিল বুঝতেই পারছেন, 17 দিন হাসপাতালে, মানে বুঝতেই পারছেন যা হয়েছিল আর কি। যাই হোক, আমি বলবো ওনাকে, তারপর তো আপনি ফলো আপ রাখবেন।
ঠিক আছে।
Yes, I am back now. If anybody is having any question in factor analysis, please, you can ask me. Anyone is having any question or want to discuss something? Yes, please.
Sir,
yes.
If the variables are, binomial type, binomial means, I mean, I want to say dichotomous type, 0-1 pattern, then too we cannot use PCA.
Very important question. We cannot apply factor analysis because we cannot do PCA on such type of data. But there is another technique which is called latent class analysis. Then rather than using factor analysis, we use what is called latent class analysis.
Sir, multivariate analysis, MCA, multiple correspondence analysis is a part of that?
No. Correspondence analysis is something different and latent class analysis is something different. Latent analysis is used when we have dichotomous variable like 1010 or 1212. Then we use latent class analysis rather than going for factor analysis.
Sir, I have a request. Before you take our structural equation modeling, I have a request that can you provide us the PPT because I think I need that one.
Yes, sir. This is a request from my side also.
No. I'll give you the PPT. Don't worry at all. I will send it to Sarah and Sarah will give you. Okay.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Sure. Okay. So let's go to now structure equation modeling. And if all of you have joined, then please, because the terminology is a little bit different and you haven't learned, even people from statistics, they are not very much aware of structure equation modeling, right? It's a slightly a technique which is a combination of multiple regression and factor analysis. It's a technique which is a combination of factor analysis and multiple regression analysis together. If you combine both of them, you call this as structure equation modeling. There are multiple relationships between variables. So how you can show that which variables is related to which variable, what is its weight or regression coefficients, whether it is significant or not. So that is the task of structure equation modeling, right? So try to understand the terminology behind structure equation modeling. And then I can take only one example for structure equation modeling because time is not enough, because you people have joined today at 6:15 rather than 6 o'clock. So 15 minutes have been lost. And if you give me another 15 minutes, maybe I'll able to cover, otherwise I'll leave in between. Okay. The objective of structure equation modeling. So analysis is, we will be teaching you through a software, which is called MOS. MOS is called analysis of moment structure. If you remember my first talk, I discuss about the variance, and in variance I have written M2 because power was 2. I call this as second order moment. And then in skewness and kurtosis, I used M3, M4, third order moment, fourth order moment. Hopefully you remember that, right? In my first lecture. Now the entire SEM, structure equation modeling, why it is called analysis of moment structure? Because it is based on moments. Moments means it is based on correlation and covariances. So covariances and correlation, they can be written in terms of moments. And the name comes analysis of moment structures. Mean, SD, etc., that doesn't make much of the sense here. Correlations, it is basically correlation type of analysis. Okay, so structure equation modeling, what is this? So it's a multivariate technique is used to analyze structural relationship. How many relationship exist, whether they are significant or not. So it's a combination of factor analysis and multiple regression analysis, right? So structure equation modeling is basically a diverse techniques as path analysis, confirmatory factor analysis, causal modeling with latent variables, right? I'll explain you what do you mean by latent variable, what do you mean by path analysis, CFA, I have already explained. So all this terminology I'll explain you. And SCM is an extension of general linear model, right? Okay. So as I mentioned that it is interrelated dependence technique, interrelated, how the variables are interrelated among themselves. Okay. Then to do so, they examine the structure relationship between them, just like we do in multiple regression, but it's advanced stage of multiple regression. So it is not an explanatory factor analysis. It is confirmatory factor analysis. So estimate the, as for example, whenever we are writing in economics model also, y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2 plus beta k xk plus epsilon, that is error, or EI, right? So EI is written always at the end and we want to minimize this error. But remember, there could be error associated with x1, there could be error associated with x2, it could be associated with x3, x4, x6, all of them, there could be error, right? So obviously multiple regression analysis doesn't take care of that error, but it is being taken care of in structure equation modeling. It will tell you how much error is associated with x1, measurement error, how much measurement error is associated with x2, and so on, right? So it includes both unobserved variables are called latent variable. I'll give you examples, just wait for a moment. Unobserved variables are called latent variable. So it includes both latent variable and observed variables. For example, we just completed the factor analysis. And in factor analysis, one of the factor which was coming out, CS1, CS, it was based on four variables. That was, we call this as customer satisfaction. It was called customer satisfaction. The customer satisfaction is not known to you, but it has been measured through CS1, CS2, CS3, and CS4. They are called indicators. They are indicators of customer satisfaction, right? So customer satisfaction is a latent variable. While CS1, CS2, CS3, CS4, they are indicator variables. They are observed variables. So it includes both latent as well as observed variables. Okay. So estimate complex relationship you can find out. Let's look at some structure equation modeling is also has some other names. For example, this is also called simultaneous equation modeling. Sometimes this is called analysis of covariance structures. Sometimes also called causal analysis. So all these are synonymous. These three are synonymous. And path analysis and confirmatory factor analysis, CFA. They are particular cases of SEM, structure equation modeling. When we use path analysis, when we deal only with observed variables, all the variables are observed variables, then we use path analysis. But if we have a combination of observed variables and also the latent variables, then we use confirmatory factor analysis, just like in factor analysis we have seen, right? Okay, now what kind of relationship could be there? One of the relationship is called direct effect. Direct effect means how X is impacting Y, right? If height is changing, let's say for a growing child, if height is changing, what is the effect on weight? Whether weight is also increasing or not? Direct effect. Then there are certain spurious effect also. That X and Y, I cannot say anything, but Z is having impact on X, Z is having impact on Y. This kind of effect is called spurious effect. Then this is called mediating variable. There is a mediator. So there we first look at the relationship of X with that mediator and that mediator with Y. So this is called indirect effect. Then moderating effect. There could be a moderator variable. How this is going to moderate between this and this. And then correlation relationship. Please remember, correlation relationship is always studied with a double arrow. So arrow, double arrow. This is, you can see there is arrow on both sides. While in all other relationship, we have arrow on one side only. While this correlation or covariance is studied through double arrow. So different kind of relationship exist. Very important model, which is called customer satisfaction model or American customer satisfaction model. Here you can see multiple relationship. For example, let's say I look at perceived quality. Perceived quality is affected by customer expectation. Perceived quality, because arrow is going towards this. This is the tail, this is the head, right? So where from this to this, that means this variable is impacting this. So customer expectation is impacting perceived quality. And if you look at this thing, perceived value, it is impacted by perceived quality as well as customer expectation. So in the same variable, now if I'm looking at this variable, this could be considered dependent variable and these two will be independent variable. While in this case, if I'm just looking at these two, this becomes dependent variable, this becomes independent. So at the same time, sometimes it plays the role of dependent, sometimes it plays the role of independent variables, right? Then all the three variables, if you combine them together, they are leading to overall customer satisfaction. So overall customer satisfaction is a result of perceived quality, perceived value, and customer expectation. All of them, they are leading to this. And further, the overall customer satisfaction can have certain adverse effect also, some loyal effect also. Adverse effect is whether the customers is having complaints. So customer complaints, then customer loyalty. And then there could be a relationship between complaints and loyalty. So very complex type of structure. And now, if I'm going for a multiple regression, now how many equations you can form? First equation will be, this will be dependent, this will be independent. Second will be this will become dependent, these two are become independent. Third will be this will be dependent, these three will become independent. So how many equations can be formed? Number of equations can be formed. But question here is, the important point here is, in structure equation modeling, you can have only one diagram, and this will give you whether this is positively impacting, whether it is significant or not. Coefficients value will be displayed at the arrow, and you will come to know what is the impact of which variable on the other, right? So this is studied through structure equation modeling. Important, very, very important technique where a complex structure behavior can be studied. I'm just leaving this example. So look at some notations, very important notations. Please remember these notations. You can write down also because they are given in the MOS package, analysis of movement structure. For example, if I'm using ellipse or circle, ellipse or circle is always used for unobserved variables. Unobserved variables means which you cannot observe directly, like customer satisfaction. I cannot observe, but it is observed through CS1, CS2, 3, 3, CS4. So if I want to have any latent variable has to be put under ellipse or circle. Okay. Then rectangle or square. Rectangle or square are used for observed variables. Like if I want to put CS1, CS2, CS3, CS4, I can put under this. Please remember, circle or ellipse is used for unobserved variable. For observed variable, square or rectangle is used. Okay. And if there is a single arrow pointing from A to B, then this simply says what is the impact of A on B. And if there is both the arrows are there, on this side arrow, this side, that means we are looking at the relationship between A and B. This is studied through covariance or correlation. So if there is a double arrow, then there is no effect of one on another. But what we are looking for is some kind of relationship between the two, right? So the important point here is that if unobserved variable is there, either we represent it by circle or ellipse. Observed variable, rectangle or square. Single arrow, one variable is impacting another. Double arrow, we are looking for correlation. Hopefully the symbols notation is clear. Now, we have to study go through some other definitions, very, very important. Nomenclature and representation. First of all, we have to understand what do you mean by latent variable versus observed variables, although you already know now. Because if you remember the first example of factor analysis, we were coming out with two factors. I have given one factor name as the health benefit factor. That was your latent variable. Name I have suggested, but it was measured through what? It was measured through three variables, V1, V3 and V5. They were observed variables. So latent variable versus observed variables. Then important terminology in structure equation modeling is exogenous latent variable and endogenous latent variable. Endogenous is basically dependent latent variable. Exogenous is basically independent latent variable. Now, how it can be recognized that this is endogenous and this is exogenous? Very simple. Let me go through this example. This one. You remember, if your arrow is pointing towards this, then this is called endogenous construct, E-N-D-O, endogenous. And where the tail of the arrow is there, this is called exogenous. So this is your exogenous. Similarly, this one is your endogenous. While the same variable, which was previously playing the role of endogenous, now if you consider this as endogenous, this will play the role of exogenous and this will be another exogenous variable. Similarly, this will be endogenous and this will be exogenous. How you can determine? Look at the arrow. The tail of the arrow means exogenous latent variables. And head of the arrow means endogenous variables, right? So this is how we generally call this as the difference between endogenous latent variables and exogenous latent variables. Then the reflective construct versus formative construct. What do you mean by reflective construct? Reflective means that your construct is reflected by these components. For example, customer satisfaction is reflected through four components: CS1, CS2, CS3, and CS4. So that is a reflective construct. That means your construct calls the variables. Your construct calls the variables. And in formative construct, it is opposite. Your variables cause the construct. Your variables call, I will give you some examples. Your variables cause the construct, then this is called formative. If construct is causing the variables, then it is a reflective construct. And let me tell you, structure equation modeling deals only with reflective construct. It doesn't deal with formative construct. For formative construct, we use another technique, which is called PLS, partial least square estimation, partial least square, PLS. And it is an add-on in Excel, which is called smart PLS. So we can do, if there is a formative construct, we can handle this with the help of smart PLS. But MOS handles reflective construct. Then there is a difference between recursive and non-recursive model. What is recursive and non-recursive model? If your arrow is from A to B, then it's a recursive model. But if arrow is B to A, again, let's say A is impacting B, B is also impacting A, then it becomes non-recursive model, right? Then measurement model versus structure model. In measurement models, we simply have the relationship of the different constructs. For example, one of the construct was customer satisfaction. Another construct was ER. Another construct was IS. Another was SC, staff competence. If you are looking at the relationship between these construct, then that is a part of measurement model. But if the literature says that the customer satisfaction is dependent on ER, it depends upon IS, it depends upon SC, then it becomes structure model, right? So measurement model means only the covariances or correlations among the different constructs. Structure model means one or two constructs may be dependent, others may be independent, okay? Or endogenous or exogenous, okay? For example, look at this one. Endogenous versus exogenous latent variables. Let's say we look at PU. PU is called perceived usefulness, and PEOU is called perceived ease of use, right? So this is a latent construct. It's not directly observable. That's why I put the circle or an ellipse. You remember the notation. And this is observed through what? It is observed through three variables, PU1, PU2, PU3. And I put a rectangle over here. Why? Because they are observed variables. And for any observed variable, there will be error. So for this, error is E1. For this, error is E2. For this, error is E3. So this is one of the construct. Similarly, this is another construct, perceived ease of use. It is not directly measurable. It is measured through PEOU 1, 2, 3, and 3. And there are errors for this. But if you consider all these two together, right? So if I just put one mark here, from here to here, it's a measurement model, because this is another measurement model. But if I'm connecting the two constructs, let's say this is endogenous construct now, this is exogenous. Look at the head. Head of the arrow is towards endogenous. Tail is towards exogenous. So if you just forget about the rest of the diagram, I put a line here, then this becomes a structure model because we are looking at the relationship between the two. Similarly, further this, intention to use, is it measured through use 1, use 2, use 3. And then we are, this is endogenous construct, it is measured through this and this. Again, it's a part of, all this becomes a structure model. Okay, reflective versus formative construct. Now please try to understand very clearly, these examples are not given in any book. They come out of the experience only. Reflective constructs. Reflective constructs are based on the assumption that latent variable cause the measured variables. So it's a latent variable put into oval shape. They are causing, arrows are pointing, they are causing these observed variables, right? I'll give you example also. So structure equation modeling deals with only reflective, so we have to go for only reflective, but the difference should be clear. Look at this one, reflective construct. What is a reflective construct? For example, service quality is not directly measurable, but it is measured through three components: price, promotion, and the people you are targeting. So service quality is the reflection of these three components, or service quality reflect these. So that's why called reflective construct. Now here you can very well understand. For example, if somebody is having a fever, now how do you measure fever? You put a thermometer in his mouth or in her mouth, note down the temperature. Now let me, you just answer my question. Are you measuring a fever or you are measuring a temperature? Yes, please, anybody. Are you measuring a temperature or you are measuring fever? Yes, please.
You are
not measuring fever, right? You are measuring
temperature.
Okay, so now fever is measured through body temperature. It is measured through body ache, which can be used. You can use 5-point scale to measure body ache. It can be measured through headache, right? So these fever is reflected through this, but fever is a not measurable quantity. So this is a latent construct. This is another latent construct, right? So this is what do you mean by reflective construct. Now let me give you an example of the formative construct also. Formative constructs are based on the assumption that the measured variable caused the construct. These, its arrow is opposite totally. This is going to lead to this. This is going to lead to this. This is going to lead to this. And there is no error then here. There is no error here. Error is at this point only. But this MOS cannot handle this. This is handled by smart PLS, right? So that's a formative construct. I'll give you one example of formative, real life example of formative and reflective construct that will make you very clear what is the difference. So here is the example. Reflective versus formative. Here, latent construct is drunkenness. I cannot measure drunkenness. Here it is also drunkenness. Both of them are same, but see how the behavior changes. Now drunkenness, if the person is unable to walk properly, can't straight, he is moving haphazardly, he is smelling from the mouth, he is having slurred speech, that means you can say that the person is a drunk, because he is having all the three: slurred speech, smell, can't walk properly. So that means this person is a drunk. But your drunkenness is reflected through this. It's a reflective construct. Look at the formative. It's also drunkenness. Now, drunkenness, maybe he is taking only beer, consumption of beer, consumption of wine, consumption of hard liquid. They are causing the drunkenness. It's a formative. So if the indicator variable, these are called indicator variable or observed variables. If indicator or observed variable, they are causing the construct, then it is formative. But if your construct is causing the indicators, then it's reflective. Yes, please. Is this clear? Anybody? Is this clear? Hello?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. Very good. Now, as far as reflective construct and formative constructs are constructs are there, reflective constructs, they are very well defined in literature. You can check their convergent validity, divergent validity, phase validity, numerological validity. Everything can be checked easily. But as far as formative constructs are concerned, literature is not very much clear about convergent, divergent validity, etc. Convergent means how these variables, they are causing a particular construct. So it's very well known in reflective, but it's not very well established under formative constructs. So, but we will be referring only to the reflective constructs. So path analysis, as I mentioned, we only deal with observed variables. Let's say food preference measured on, say, 5-point scale. It depends upon three components: food taste, measured on 5-point scale; food quality, measured on 5-point scale; food nutrition, measured on 5-point scale. All of them are measurable quantities. And we want to draw a path diagram. So path diagram deals with observed variables only. You can see I have just used rectangles. There is no oval shape. Oval shape is only with the error, because error is not measurable. It is unobserved. And whenever the arrow is pointing, you always have to put an error, right? Yeah. So there, we always have to put an error. So forget about this error. Otherwise, these three are measurable quantities. So that constitutes your what is called path diagram. So path diagram deals only with observed variables. Remember, structure equation model versus measurement model. Very, very important. Please try to understand the difference. I have already explained you. In measurement model, you are simply looking at how the constructs are related to each other. That's it. Let me just repeat. In measurement model, you are simply looking at how the constructs are related to each other. While in structure model, there could be one of the construct could be endogenous, rest of them, they could be exogenous. If that is the case, that means if there are double arrows in your model, double arrows, then it's a measurement model. And if one of the construct or more than two constructs are having single arrow, then it becomes a structure model. Yes, please. Is this clear? The difference between measurement model and structure model? Anybody? Yes, please. Okay, let me give you an example. For example, this is one of the construct. This is perceived use of quality. This is perceived usefulness. Okay, it is measured through this. It is measured through. Now I'm using the oval shape for unobserved. Here, what is the sign of the arrow? Error is double arrow. See, double arrow. Whenever there is a double arrow, we are looking at relationship between different constructs. And relationship between different construct means we are looking at measurement model. Yes, please. Is this okay now? Hello? Hello?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Please remember, these are called loadings. So we will be getting whether this is having high weightage, this is having high weightage, or this is having high or low weightage. So these are called factor loadings. Similarly, these are factor loadings. They are known as regression coefficients. Just like in multiple regression, we are having regression coefficients. And there will be errors. They will also be measurable quantities. Okay. Now, you can easily understand now that what is the difference between structure and measurement model. Here, the error is, there is a single error. That means this construct is exogenous construct, and this is endogenous construct. And whenever there is endogenous construct, we have to put an error. This is another error we have put in. Just right. And it is measured through this. This is measured through. So there is a single arrow between the two construct. It's a structure model. If there is a double arrow in all the constructs, it's a measurement model. You are not looking at impact of one construct on another. Then it's a measurement model. But if you are looking at, then it becomes a structure model. Yes, please. Is this clear? Hello.
Anyone? Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. These terminology is slightly different from other regression techniques which you have learned so far. For example, look at this one. I have combined here both of them. Here is oval shape. That means this is unobserved variable. Measured through variable number one, variable number two, rectangle. So this is a measurement model A. This is also measurement model B. This is measurement model C. But now if I combined all of them to look at the relationship of one construct on another, this construct on this, then all of them, this becomes, what is this becomes? It becomes structure model. So measurement model and structure model, if you are individually looking at, this is a measurement model, measurement model, measurement model. If you're combinedly looking at, it's a structure model. Yes, please. Is this clear? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. Then basic of structure equation modeling includes, we will be having observed correlation matrix, observed correlation between the model, between the variables. Then we will get the estimated matrix from the model. And if they are very, very close together, that means your model is good and it results into better fit. But if they are quietly apart from each other, then it is not a very good fit. So there are measures of goodness of fit and badness of it under structure equation modeling. EFA versus CFA. Let me give you examples of EFA versus CFA. this is EFA, explanatory factor analysis. This is confirmatory factor analysis. If you remember, in EFA, which what we have done, there were certain loadings, also cross loadings in second example. That means one of the variables was loading onto factor one also and factor two also. Yes, you remember, please? You remember that part?
Yes, sir. Hello.
So in factor analysis, you are not sure whether V1 can load to factor one, it can also load to factor two, right? Similarly, V2, V3, they can load anywhere. No idea, right? But in confirmatory factor analysis, once you apply the confirmatory factor analysis, you will be 100% sure. You will be 100% sure that V1 and V2, they are under factor one, and V3 and V4, they are under factor two. That's called confirmatory factor. You have confirmed from EFA to CFA that yes, only these two are constructing this, only these two are constructing this. Hopefully the difference is clear. Yes, please. Is this okay?
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. All right. Now, very important terminology, because before I come to the practical example, I should look into some of the technical terms, whether your model is identified or not. For example, there is a latent construct here. It is measured through X1 and X2. There are two errors associated with this. So when we go through the structure equation modeling, how many parameters will be estimated? Now, these are only two observed variable X1, X2. So I have written here the matrix. Matrix is X1, X2, X1, X2. So first X1 and X2 will give you a variance of X1. X1 and X2 will give you a covariance between X1 and X2. One means X1, two means X2. Similarly, this is covariance between two and one. Two and one is same as one and two. Whether you multiply four with three, you will get 12, or you multiply three with four, you will get 12. So it is same thing like that. And this is variance of two, variance of X2. So these, the bold are known to you from the data, where you can compute variance, you can compute covariance. So three things are known to you. One, covariance, and these two variances. But how many parameters you want to estimate? Two coefficients, this and two errors. So you want to estimate four, but there are three known quantities. And what are degrees of freedom? You can write down, please. Degrees of freedom are nothing but known values minus unknown values. So your known values are three. You know variance of X1, you know variance of X2, you know variance of covariance of X1 and X2. That's all. So three known values. But how many parameters you want to estimate? Unknown. One, two, three, four. Four parameters you have to estimate. So your degrees of freedom will become three minus four, minus one. And if the degrees of freedom are negative, then this is called unidentified model. This is called unidentified model. And you cannot run an unidentified model in structure equation modeling. Hopefully the idea is clear. Yes, please. Is this okay? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Now, then second type of model is called just identified model. In just identified model, your degrees of freedom may be zero. But if you are running a path analysis, it will run, but not structure equation modeling. Path analysis you can run on just identified model. Even if degrees of freedom are zero, still you can run. How? Let's say there are three indicators, X1, X2, X3. So how many parameters you need to estimate? Three loadings. I have put LX1, LX2, LX3 loadings. Three loadings and three errors, so six. But how many things are known to you, which are in the bold? X1, X2, X3. Bold is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six are known, and six you have to estimate. So 6 minus 6, your degrees of freedom will be 0. This model is called just identified model. Just identified model. Right? Okay. And now,
sir, we can estimate just identified model, right?
You could, in path, for path analysis only, okay, where there are observed variables. But if there is a structure model, you cannot. For structure model, you need over-identified model. Okay?
Okay.
Now, what is over-identified? Let's say I take one more X4. If I take X4, then what will happen? There will be four loadings, four errors, eight. But how many variances, covariances will be there? your variances, covariances will be actually, they will be 10. There will be 10. And 10 minus 8 will give you 2. And 10 minus, you can put x4, you can put x5. And then look at the lower triangular matrix, you will get 10 values here. So 10 values are known to you, 8 parameters you have to estimate. This is an exercise to you. So 10 minus 8 will be 2. So your model will be over-identified. And structure equation model works only for over-identified degrees of freedom. You follow my point? Yes, yes, please. Sir. Yes. Okay. So identification is very, very important. And sample size, I will give you this presentation. Sample size consideration are very simple. If you have 16 variables, some are under one construct and some are under another construct, there are three constructs, 16 variables, then what should be your sample size? At least 10 times of the number of variables. If you have 16 variables, you should have 160 observations. Sample size should be 160. That is an ideal situation. But at least 5 is also acceptable. So 16 into 5, 80. But you should not have less than 80. If you have less than 80, you cannot run structured equation modeling. So that is the rule of thumb. Okay. Then how to measure whether we have a good fit or we have a bad fit? So there are three important indicators to look at good or bad fit, right? How to look at the goodness of fit measures? One of them is called, these are three measures of goodness of fit. One of them is called absolute model fit. Another is called incremental model fit. Third one is called parsimonious model fit, right? So what are these absolute model fit? So in absolute model fit, you look at the three values. One is chi-square value and probability should be greater than 0.05, right? That means this should be known significant. Your chi-square value must be known significant because it is giving you the difference between the actual value and the estimated value. And if they are very close, then it should be non-significant. Difference is non-significant. So p-value must be greater than 0.05. Then another absolute model fit is root mean square error approximation, which is generally called RMSEA. It should be less than 0.08. Goodness of fit index, GFI, should be more than 0.9. These are covered under absolutely fit index. Then incremental fit index also covers 4. This is called adjusted goodness of fit index. This is called comparative fitness fit index. This is called normed fit index. This is called Tucker-Lewis index. So all these values should be more than 0.9. But even if they are more than 0.8, acceptable. So incremental fit indices, very important. All these values, they should be more than 0.9. But even if they are above 0.8, acceptable. Okay. And the last one is parsimonious fit. Here we will get chi-square divided by degrees of freedom. And this is called minimum discrepancy. And minimum discrepancy value should be less than 5. It should be, if it is less than 4, very good. If it is less than 2, excellent model. Between 2 to 4 is acceptable model. But less than 5 is just borderline case. And more than 5 is not acceptable at all. Parsimonious fit. So we look at whether our model is good or bad from the three points of view. One of them is called absolute fit, absolute model fit. Another is incremental model fit. Then parsimony model fit. All these values will be given by MOS. You just have to see whether they are falling into your limits or not. Right? Okay. Then if your model is not good, let's say your minimum discrepancy is coming out to be around 4.5 and you want to improve it. You want that this should come below 4 or below 3. Then we use modification indices. We can modify our model. Similarly, if let's say RSMI value is, let's say it is coming out to be 1.02 and we want this to be less than 0.08, then we can use modification indices. So there are modification indices which joins the errors which are highly correlated, and based on that we go for model modification indices, right? I'll show you practically. Then the this I have already discussed. So what we need to report in the final thing, we report minimum discrepancy, C mean divided by degree of freedom, root mean square error of approximation. This should be less than 0.08. Then goodness of fit index, then adjusted good net of fit index, root mean error, then comparative fit index, Tucker-Lewis index, incremental fit index, and normed fit index. These values we report. All these incremental, they should be more than 0.9, but desirable, even if it is more than 0.8, it is acceptable. This should be less than 0.08. This should also be less than 0.08. Okay, and this should be less than 4 is very good, less than 2 is excellent, but less than 5, let's say between 4 and 5 is a borderline case. Okay, so this is what we need to report finally. Okay, then we are also looking for convergent validity. We will also look for divergent validity, and convergent and divergent validity are given in MOS. Convergent validity means that how the indicator variables are representing a particular construct. This is how they converge to a particular construct measured through convergent validity, right? Then discriminant validity. Discriminant validity means how one construct is discriminating from the other. This is called discriminant validity. So I'll show you. Then, as I mentioned, we always compute Cronbach alpha for different type of constructs. I have already shown this to you. And then finally, we look at the acceptance values of Cronbach alpha for each construct should be more than 0.7, but 0.6 and above, they are also acceptable. Then finally, we have to look for composite reliability. Composite reliability has to be more than 0.7, right? It has to be more than 0.7. And then indicator reliability is nothing but factor loadings. They should be 0 and 1 point, should be more than 0.5. Convergent validity, there are indicators for convergent validity. We have to check. I have already shown you. Then average variance expected should be more than 0.5. Average variant expected, AVE, we call this, should be more than 0.5. Discriminant validity, we have to check whether the average variance extracted is greater than what is called maximum squared variance or not. If it is, then the discriminant validity is established. Okay, so this I'm skipping. And these are all fit measures. Goodness of fit is GFI, AGFI. Badness of fit measures, chi-square, all these, they should be less. Goodness of fit for incremental is all the, where you can see attach I means incremental fit indices. Then parsimonious fit include these two, PGFI, parsimonious goodness of fit, parsimonious normed fitness of index. So all these we need to check, and these are their values. Goodness of fit measures, value, desirable value is more than 0.9, but acceptable is more than 0.8. Bad measures, they should have less than this, and composite reliability should be more than 0.7. Now, all these things, basics are required before moving on to structure equation modeling. Anji, dimag khali ho gaya? Yes, please. It's not an easy topic to teach, but anyhow, now I'll give you a practical example so that you can understand how we can enter the data in MOS. At least initially you can. So this is called MOS. I'll be now talking of MOS graphics. Just click here. After you download, just click here, and this kind of screen will appear. This type of screen will appear. You can see the screen. This is the, you can say, canvas of the structure equation modeling. Okay. And now, how to enter the data? Question is, how to enter the data? So first time I have seen this, I was a little bit curious how we can work on structure equation modeling. Right. So obviously you require data, but before coming to the data, you always go to the view. You can note down the steps, please. View, then interface properties, and just increase the size of this canvas. So otherwise, size of this canvas is where you can see the white area, but you can increase from here. View, interface properties, and you can have this as landscape A4. landscape A4, and you can see the canvas area has increased, so that you can put your constructs in a diagram, right? Okay. All right. So something, for example, this oval shape is used for whenever you click, what is written here? Draw unobserved variable. That means, as I mentioned, this is for unobserved variables and this is for observed variables, right? For example, if I click here, I can mark here. You can mark like this. So that means I can represent my construct that this is an unobserved variable. And by mistake, if you have some, let's say some stretchable part or something, it happens, something like this has happened, you can, there is a eraser also, you can erase this, right? Okay. And if you want observed variables, you can like type this. These are all observed variables. And then if you want to delete this, you can delete, right? Let's say I put one of the observed variables, let's say, and there are four observed other variables which are of the similar type, then you can use this what is called duplicate objects. So it will duplicate. It will duplicate further. It will duplicate further. So it will be of the same size. You won't face any difficulty then, right? Then these are the arrows which you can point out. This is arrow from here to here, error from here to here, error from here to here. And these arrows are somewhere going, then this is called notch up button or touch up button. You click this and click on this, click on this, the click on this, click on this. So it will beautify your picture, right? So it's just like doing a drawing, right? And let's say this is selecting one of the object. I want to move only this one. Let's say I want to move this, then you select this one. Select this and this will become blue. You can see I selected only one of the object. And if I want to move this, use this truck. With the truck, you can move anywhere. Truck will move your objects to anywhere, right? Okay. And let's say I want to move this one. This one you can move here. This one a little bit here, this one little. You can adjust accordingly. Okay, this is truck to move on. Then once you have a path diagram, because we have put only observed variables, they are in the rectangle. Then you want to give a title, so you can assign a title from here. Let's say I assign a title that this is a path diagram. Path diagram, just OK press kariye aur ye aapka yahan pe aa gaya. Path diagram likha hua, right? Then you can copy this picture and paste it in Word or anywhere. So I'm telling you small things first of all, so that you should be get familiar with the some kind of idea that how the MOS operates, right? Then let's say there are other symbols also. This is to move, and then this is an because arrows are pointing here, I have to put a error here. So how to put error? This is a symbol for error. So error will be put here, right? So this is how you can enter the variables. Now I will take up one example because we are left with 15-20 minutes maximum, and I'll take up one example to solve your problem so that you can have a feel of today how we can move with the structure equation modeling. I'll take the same example where we are able to obtain four indicators, customer satisfaction with four variables, then ER, which is easiness and reliability with four variables, then IS, information security and quality, six variables, and staff competence with six variables, right? So I'm just removing this, delete. Yes, okay. How do you like this? Yes, please, anybody? Yes, please, anyone? How do you like this? Did you able to understand something?
Yes, sir, it is nice.
Okay, let's take some data file and explain it to you how we can do the structure equation modeling. Okay, now how to choose the data set? So there is a three options here. One is called select data files. Another is analysis property, what do you want to analyze, and then calculate estimates. These, please focus on these three. Now, once we enter the data from select, I will select the data file. Then you move on to what is called the list of variables in the data set. It will show you the list of the variables in the data set. And this will give you the list of the variables in the model, right? So these two are important. This is list of the variables in the data set. This is the list of the variables in the model. And this is, first of all, we go for loading of the data. Let's say I want to load a file. Okay, it says, what is your file name? So click on to file name. So our file name was me. I think somewhere it is written. Yeah, this file, me.sen. Okay, press open. You can either load the CSV file. If the CSV file is there, it will also read the CSV file. Or if it is SPSS file, it will also read the SPSS file. Doesn't matter, right? Press open. Now it says there are 290 observations. All have been loaded, 219 to 290. Now, if you want to view the data, where is your data? So you can view the data and it will open in SPSS because it's an SPSS file. And if it is an Excel file with CSV, it will open in CSV. So these are the variables. If you remember, we have done factor analysis on this, right? You remember, I think, this example, right? So it says this is your data file. And we have four constructs here. One of the constructs is CS, another is ER, another is IS, another is SC. Yes, so there are four construct. So I need a four construct, but first of the construct will have how many variables? Four variables. Then ER will be having again four variables, and IS is having six, and SC is also having six. So I need a combination of four, four, six, six. Okay, just remember this thing. You can write down and then. So I'm just closing this file. I have shown you the file. Okay, now you press OK. So variables are there. All the variables are loaded in your MOS now. So look for the variables. Before looking at the variables, now try to draw your construct. So for construct, this is this you click on. First construct is CS. So you have to click it four times, because there are four indicators, CS1, CS2, CS3, CS4. So this is first time, second time, third time, fourth time, right? Then this is CS. Then another was ER. ER was also four times. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Then IS. IS was six times. So click on six times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then there was another one. The last one, SC, was also six times. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So these are all here, right? So this is to load the data. So these are nothing but coming out of the EFA, explanatory factor analysis, right? All right. Now you can move their shapes also. Let's say I want to move this shape to downwards. So this will move downwards. This will rotate downwards. It's up to you. And if you want to preserve the symmetry, this is called preserve symmetry. If you click onto this preserve symmetry and take the track along, then you can move slightly this one here. You can move. If it is something going out of the canvas, you can make adjustments, right? Similarly, you can make adjustment here. You can make some kind of adjustment here. Let's say this below this. All right, okay. But if you don't press preserve symmetry and track together, then only one part, for example, if I take this, then only this will move, and that will hamper your entire picture. So you must look into that you have taken care of the preserve symmetry and then this. Then the whole picture will move. For example, this preserve symmetry and then track, it will move the whole object. Yes, please. These things are clear. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now how to load the data? How to load the data? This is your data, list of data variables. Click here and all the variables, they will appear here. You can move it anywhere. Take it here. Now, what is this variable? The first variable is having four components, CS. So I'll take CS. Now you should not just drag and drop. You just drag it here, do not lift, and unless the red button appears. When red button appears, just drop it here. So this is CS1, then CS2, then CS3, then CS4, right? Now CS is over, you shift this. Next is ER1, ER2, ER3, ER4. Sorry, this is going out. If it is going out, then you remove from here and take it again. Doesn't matter. So ER4. All right. Then just stretch this little bit and you can see rest of them. You can move anywhere. Let's say next is IS1. When red button will appear, immediately you drop it. IS3, IS4, IS5, IS6. All right. Then you are left with the last one. That is SC1, SC2, SC3, SC4, SC5, and SC6. All right, close this. Now you have your data is loaded in this, right? Now you have to assign this as a name. Name of this construct is CS. So you can write here CS. Name of this construct is ER. So I will write ER. Name of this construct is IS. And the name of this construct is SC, staff competence. So you have assigned the name. Now, errors, we have to give the name E1, E2, E3. Now, if you assign errors yourself, it will take long time. But there is option in MOS. You go through the plugins. There is a plugin option here. Plugin. And in plugin, there is what is called name unobserved variables. These are all unobserved variables now, right? So just name unobserved variables. All the errors will be marked. You can see all the errors have appeared. You will not have to mark yourself. You will not have to mark yourself. All the errors are there. Yes, please. Is this clear?
Hello.
Could you please repeat the step, last step?
Last step is there were some errors.
Incorporating the error terms.
Pardon? Yes, I am repeating now. I just press Control Z. Now you are at the previous picture. Just put here, this variable was CS. This variable name is ER. This variable name is IS. This latent construct variable name is SC. Is it clear now up to this?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then go to plugins. Now these are unobserved. Errors are unobserved. These are all unobserved variables. Now if you start, you can put your own errors, E1, E2, E3, but that will take a long time. So MOS, there is a flexibility. Go to plugins and then fourth from the last is name unobserved variables. Can you see that? Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
Click here and all the errors will be marked. Okay. Is this clear?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Now for a measurement model, we have to connect what? We have to connect the covariances term for measurement model. First, we have to develop the measurement model, right? So measurement model means how to join this with this, this with this. So one of the way is to join. I can use this, right? Or if this is not very good for you, you can join from here. You can move like this. Then you can move like this. You can move like this. It's up to you. All the errors will be connected, but it's a very tedious process because if there are more construct, some of the, you may be unable to join. Then how you delete this, when red appears, that means you can delete. The best way is you mark all the four constructs which you want to have the covariances. So let's say I select, this is selecting one object at a time. So select this, it will become blue. Select this, it will become blue. Select this, it will become blue. This will become blue. Then go to plugins again. And in plugins, there is the option draw covariances. And click onto this simply. If you click onto all the covariances will be drawn automatically. There'll be, you cannot lose track of anything. Yes, please. Is this okay?
Yes, sir.
Hello. All right.
Yes, sir.
Now Now everything is ready. Your diagram is ready. You have to run the model now, right? But before running the model, question is, what do you want to compute? What do you want to compute? So let's go for, this is called analysis property. This was for loading the data. Now we have to go for analysis property. What do you want to compute? So we have to compute all these coefficients, right? So go for this. Analysis properties. In analysis properties, do not click anything here. Do not click anything here. Straight away go to output, please. There are YouTube videos. Mere bhi YouTube videos hain. Agar aapko phir bhi structure equation modeling mein doubt lagta hai, to aap YouTube pe aap search karke mera video dhoond sakte hain. Ke structure equation modeling by Suresh K. Sharma. Aur aapko mil jayenge. Aur ye sara kuch maine wahan pe bhi discuss kiya hua hai. To agar aapko kahin doubt lagta hai, to wahan se seekh sakte hain. Okay. Go to output. Now in output, there is a left panel, there is a right panel. Please remember what you have to click on the left hand side, what you have to click on the right hand side. This is how I remember. One is by default. You will not have to click anything. It will give you history. Then two and three, you need to click on the left hand side. One, two, three, and then the last one. One, two, three, and eight. One, two, three, and eight. Please write down in output. One, two, three, and eight. You need to click. Nothing else. Yes, please. Is this clear? Hello.
Yes, sir.
One, two, three, and last one is eight. And what you have to click on the right hand side is four and six. Where is four? One, two, three, four. Correlation. And six is test for normality and outliers. That's it. And modification indices threshold is four. Remember this thing. I'll tell you the meaning of this. So now everything you have done, your diagram is ready, your data is ready. Now you have to run the model. Just close. So everything is there. Now this is running the model. Calculate estimates. Can you see that? Yes, please.
Hello. Yes, sir.
So just press this, calculate estimates. Now it says, before you calculate your estimates, you have to save your diagram. So I'll save this diagram as workshop. Okay. If you save, I'll save this on the desktop. Save. So it has saved and the model will run. When the model will run, these two will be highlighted. If the model will not run, these will not be highlighted. You see, both of them are highlighted. Right? And chi-square value has appeared. 660, something like that. You can see the chi-square value has appeared. It should appear. It will give you. But now you want to see the path coefficients, how they are correlated, how the constructs are correlated among themselves. So click on to view the output path diagram. You see all the loadings here, you see. And if you are unable to see any loadings because they are very small sometimes, then there is a lens here. You can pick up this lens and see the loadings. For example, loading here is 0.44. This is 0.41. Loading here is 0.92. Here it is 0.35. So this is a lens you can see, right? And then you can click here, then lens will be moved. Now, for example, if I'm interested to see what is the, this is called covariance. What is the covariance between this construct ER and SC? Can you tell me what is the covariance between this? Yes, please. Hello. What is the covariance here? Anybody? Let me show you. What is the covariance here? Yes, please. Can you see that?
0.35.
There is no one.
0.35. Positive yes. Correlation.
Yeah. So there, no, this is not a correlation. This is a covariance.
Covariance, yes.
Covariance, positive. Right? Similarly, you can see the covariance between this and this is 0.4, covariance between IS and this is this one, and the covariance between SC and IS. SC and IS is 0.92, very high. They are correlated, right? Now, this is called a measurement model. This is called the measurement model. Plus, can Deya Shankarji, I need 10 minutes more to complete this because they have started at 6:15.
So no problem, sir. Please continue.
If the participants are ready, otherwise I'll stop. Are you ready?
Yes, sir. We are ready, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. Okay. All right.
Yes, sir.
Now, we are discussing a measurement model because you can see double arrows. All the double arrows are there. All the double arrows, right? Okay. Now, what we can do, this is called unstandardized estimates. But if you look at the standardized estimates, this will give you a correlation. What is it? This, these are covariances. Now click on to standardized estimates. Now all these are standardized estimates. For example, between this and this, correlation is 0.53. Between this and this, correlation is 0.64, and so on. Between CS and ER, correlation is 0.46, right? Now, question is, which ones are significant, which ones are non-significant? Which ones are significant and which one is non-significant? So you go to what is called text, view text output. You click on to view text. These three buttons are very, very important. These three and then this one, right? So view text. If you go to the view text, first of all, you can start from here. Analysis summary. Analysis summary on which date you have carried out this. Then it will give you notes for groups that you have 290 of your sample sizes, 290, and you are working with a recursive model. Then variable summary that you are, what are your endogenous variable? Endogenous variables are those variables. These are all endogenous variables, right? These are all exogenous variables, Then parameter summary, that how many variances and covariances have been estimated from the model. Assessing the normality. This will give you skewness and kurtosis. On the first day, I told you skewness and kurtosis, right? Then Mahan-Lobis distance will give you that, is there any two observations are apart? For example, there is a jump from at observation number four. This distance is very large. If your model is not coming out to be good, then at least you can delete fourth number of observation so that your model becomes good. Even if it is not coming out to be good, next observation that can be deleted is 124. So your sample size will become 288 then if you delete two observations. But generally one or two observations are deleted if the model is not coming out to be good. If it is coming out to be good, there is no need to delete. Okay. Then notes for models, degrees of freedom, etc. It will give you. Then come to straight away to the estimates. This is the most important. You come to estimates. Now it says that CS with CS1, CS with CS2, CS with CS3, all these are significant. If there are star, star means it is significant. That means all the components of CS are actually associated with CS. You are perfectly identified them, right? Okay, then ER, all significant. IS, all six significant. SC, all six significant. Good, very good. Then these are their standardized estimates. Standardized estimates means how, what is the correlation? What is the regression weight, basically? Regression coefficients. So this is the regression coefficients of CS with CS1, 0.92. Now, whether they are significant or not, it is given here. If double star, triple star are there, they're highly significant. So it is read from here. So all of them are, most of them are significant. Very good. Then covariances. What is the covariance between CS and ER? So it is significant. Then ER and SC, it is significant. So all these are covariances. Then correlation. This is a correlation. Correlation is to be looked at which, this is rather than looking at covariances, look for correlation. It says which constructs are correlated. You see which constructs are correlated? Look at the highest correlation. Highest correlation is between ER and IS. It says it is 0.645. Rest of it 0.680, 608 point, right? But this is the highest one. Okay. Then all these are variances. We don't require this. Then squared multiple correlation. This will help you to identify your convergent validity, divergent validity, etc. Right? So finally, you come to the model fit. So here is model fit. Now in first model fit, what you need to see is this thing, that your chi-square C minimum, the minimum discrepancy, C minimum divided by degrees of freedom. This should be, if you remember, the cutoff was 5. This should be less than 5. It is 4.0. So it is acceptable. Still around borderline. I need this to be less than 4. I need this to be less than 4 to get a better model. Then GFI, it is not, it is close to 0.9, but not 0.9. This has to be 0.9. Then if you remember RSM SE, this value has to be less than 0.08, right? Other things we don't need to check much. Okay. So these are the some of the indicators we need to check. Now there are some problems with the model. You can see they are not closer to 0.9. These are not closer to 0.9. Then obviously this is more than one RSME. This should be less than 0.08. So how I can improve upon my model? And here is an important point. How to improve upon your model? You go for modification indices. Click on to modification indices. These are all modification indices. And you try to join those errors which are highly correlated. For example, look at the correlation between E19 and E20th error, 104, very high. Is there any higher than this one? Just see. Yeah, there is one more, which is 66, E7 and E8, 66. One is 104 and another one is also here, E13 and E14. Is there anything which is beyond this? Yeah. So this is 104, which is at highest level. Please remember E19 and E20. One. Then another one, the next one is here 60. E7 and E8. E7 and E8. Then another one somewhere there was 40. That's E13 and E14. I'm just noting down because I need to join this. Now to improve upon the model, let's say I want to improve the model. Chi-square value divided by degree of freedom should come out to be less than, let's say something. If it is coming out of less than 3, very good model. So what will happen when I join these errors, E13 and E14, similarly, when you join E19 and E20 or E7 and E8, then your chi-square value will be reduced by this. Further chi-square value will be reduced by 40. Chi-square value will be reduced by 66. This is what will happen. So that chi-square divided by degree of freedom will become less and less. These are called modification indices. So I'll go back to diagram and make three. So first was E19 and E20. So click here, then this will be highlighted. Pick up this. Now you can join errors only if they are falling under a particular construct. Let's see E19 and E20. Where is E19 and E20? This is E19 and E20. They are falling under the same construct as C. So this is how I can join this E19 and E20. Another one which we can join is E7 and E8. Let's say whether they are under the same construct or not. This is E7 and E8. So I can join this. You see, first chi-square value is 660. Now it will reduce by this much amount when you join. Then another is E13 and E14. E13 and E14. This is E13 and this is E14. They are also under the same construct. So let me join this. Okay, now I have joined the errors and you go for the calculate estimates again. So now I have again calculated the estimates again. Now you can see chi-square has reduced. It has come to from 660 to 422. So obviously straight away you go to the view path diagram. You can see all the coefficients and then you look at the text. And in text, what you can see, the model fit. Now you see C min divided by degree of freedom has come down less than 3. So you are moving towards very good. Your RMR, sorry, this, if you remember, this has come to close to 0.9. As I mentioned that even if more than 0.8 is acceptable. So it's 0.88 is close to 0.9. This is also close to 0.99. And another factor which you have to see, this was the major troubling factor. It was 1.02 something. Now it has come below 0.08. So once you join these errors, you have modified your model model seems to be okay, all the things are intact, and now this is your final measurement model, and you can report this model with all the view diagrams from here, with all these estimates, right? With all these estimates, mainly we report this table, and then we go this covariances table, right? Rest of the things we do not report, and then we also report this model fit, that this is RMR, AGFI, this chi-square, this, all these things are reported. So I'll send you one or two papers that how you can write down the report finally. So this is what is called a measurement model. Now, once the measurement model is complete, then you can do, resize the path diagram. So I have just concise this. And then what you can do, you can go to file, copy to clipboard. You just copy from here and then open some Word file. Let me open the Word file and you can paste it here. So your, what has happened? Something goes wrong. Anyhow, so basically you can simply copy from here. Actually, I just zoom out. The original picture has changed. So it was finding it difficult. But which picture we have to report with standardized observation? Standardized estimates. This is standardized estimates. So this is your final picture. And I can tell you that you can go to edit and copy to clipboard, and you take this to the Word, it will go to the Word, right? I don't know what has happened, but it will go to the Word. And you can paste your diagram. So this is called the measurement model. And once the measurement model is complete, finally, in 1 minute, I will tell you how to go for structure model. Now, structure model is theory based. It says that CS is a dependent variable and all these are independent constructs. Then you click here, pick up this and remove all this. You remove all this. Remove from here, remove from here, and also remove this from here. Then this is endogenous construct and rest of them are exogenous. That one, what you can do, preserve symmetries, move this truck. Let's say I move it here so that you should not get confused somewhere. And you can use this, what is called this one. And then preserve symmetry. Use the truck to move here somewhere. This one also. Okay. Now take this. This is your endogenous construct. This is your this construct. This is this construct. And now this is an endogenous construct. I need to put an error on this. Otherwise, the model will not run. So how to put the error? This is how we can put the error. Then I need to put the error also here. So go to plugin, name unobserved variable. So this error is there. Okay. So then you need to join these, which are covariances. So just deselect all the objects, then select one object at a time. This one, this one, this one, and go to plugins. You cannot choose this one because this arrow is pointing towards this. Any variable which is having error, that should not be selected. Okay, this is, I'm going for a structure model now. Then plug in, and in plugin, draw covariances. Now all the covariances have been drawn. And all the covariances have been drawn. And now your final aim is to look for calculate estimates. So estimates have been calculated. This is your diagram. Now somebody, you may be asking why we are doing all this jugglery. Because I first of all estimated CS, then ER, SC, and IS. These were unobserved variables. Now I am seeing which one is dependent on what. So my aim is to see the most out of these three, which one is the most important for CS. That means customer satisfaction. Let's go through the standardized estimates. These are standardized estimates. You go through the view text and see the result from here. In estimates, you see CS, how CS is your endogenous construct. So the maximum p value, the lowest p value, higher is the construct, or look for CR. CR here is more. So the most impact is of staff competence on CS, right? The next one is this one, which is IS. IS is the next one, and ER is the least one. So your final result says this, that how CS is related to this. The most important component for CS is which one? Which one was the most one? I slipped out of my mind. You can see the coefficients from here. Yeah, SC was the most important, 0.43. Next one was this one, 0.20. Next one was this. But fortunately, they are all significant. You can see all of them are significant. And this is your final model, which you can report. And this model validity and everything, you will not have to show it anywhere. You will not have to write up. This has already appeared on your screen, basically. This has already appeared on your screen. I think in plugin, we have the, okay, all right. So anyhow, so this is all about the structure model and the measurement model. And it has already appeared somewhere here. Let me see if it has appeared or not. Yes, it has appeared here. And you can right click and open with the Google form. You see all the things, model fit indices. See, your table is ready. This is what the final table you have to report. Open with Google. Yeah. You see, all CFI, RMSE, everything it has reported. So everything will be there with the table.
Most probably, sir, is disconnected.
Yes.
Yes, I am trying. Yes. I am calling. অল্পটুকুর জন্য কেটে গেল জয়েন করলেন স্যার सर जॉइन कर लें सर आप म्यूट हो गए हैं सर
हाँ जी
हाँ मैं कॉल कर रहा था अभी
सॉरी अभी आपको कोई क्वेश्चन है तो पूछ लीजिए प्लीज कोई क्वेश्चन हाँ. है तो स्ट्रक्चर इक्वेशन मॉडलिंग पे थोड़ा सा टफ टेक्निक है आपको मेरा यूट्यूब वीडियो से थोड़ा और सीखना पड़ेगा यस प्लीज
यस सर
हाँ कोई क्वेश्चन है तो आप पूछ सकते हैं कोई चीज अगर बेसिक चीजें क्लियर नहीं है तो कोई भी मैं एक्सप्लेन कर सकता हूँ